project was traveling through food and wine house. So first I want to ask you a question. So maybe can I ask you, where's your family originally from?
The Philippines.
The Philippines, okay. So do you have Filipino food or food that originates from the Philippines when you have like family gatherings?
Oh yeah.
So do you have memories associated with specific types of food?
Yeah.
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 So I have that feeling with certain types of food that I've had during my travels. So why and how, I've done a lot of backpacking all over the world. I'm very thankful that I've been able to do that. So 2017, so just last year, I actually quit my job at Long Beach Memorial and went backpacking through Asia, fulfilled a lifelong dream to travel for 8 months. And then I also became a professional scuba diver in Indonesia. So I've been to 17 countries in the last 5 years. And each one of them has their own unique dishes and own unique things that I ate along the way and I really enjoyed or sometimes didn't enjoy, but it still reminds me of these countries. So I chose meals that remind me most. And as it was very interesting, as I was cooking them, like it really just brought back so many memories, like the taste, the smells, the people that I was with on these adventures. We're very lucky in California that we have a wide variety of food and a lot of different ethnic foods that we can eat, but for some people that maybe isn't the case. So I also wanted the challenge of eating meals that I cooked myself and maybe wouldn't have eaten ever again. Hands-on learning, mainly I cooked food meals myself, was very hands-on. Google searches is how I found the recipes mainly. Also went on YouTube if there was a specific way something was cooked, and I also contacted friends from these countries. So my friend Rolando, who's in Indonesia, one of the boat boys on the dive boat that I worked on, and he, you know, told me, this is how my mom makes gado-gado, and he went over it with me, and it was really fun to reconnect. So I made a map, and these are the places that we're going to go today. We're going to go on a little food adventure. Sadly, I couldn't bring food, but we're going to go on a food adventure through pictures.
She's going to tease us and make us hungry.
So by the end of the presentation, I hope that you're able to verbalize these two difficulties that may occur when learning how to cook, either other foods or ethnic foods. State one way each above difficulty could be improved the next time the dish was prepared, and list two ways in which learning how to cook ethnic food can be applied to teaching and learning. So our first stop is going to be Italy. So pizza in Italy, when I think of Italy, I think of pizza. I ate and drank my way through Italy. I spent over 60 euro on gelato. I was there for a week and a half. I had gelato like 3 times a day. And that's just what you're supposed to do when you go to Italy. So I think of pizza, I think of Italy. So I made pizza. I had never made pizza dough before, so I always just bought it at the store. And it's so easy. I think a lot of the things that I learned with this cooking project is it's so easy and it tastes so much better if you just take that extra step to make it from scratch, make it by hand. So pizza dough made from scratch, flour, water, mix it all together. The rising process, I didn't wait long enough for it to rise. I was really hungry, so I just waited half an hour, but it should rise to double the size, and it only rose like maybe a quarter of the size. So it would have been better had I waited a little bit longer. I burned the sun-dried tomatoes. They were like crispy on the top. My hair, they're really burned. So I learned that you can, that it's better certain ingredients to put on maybe halfway through the baking process or maybe at the very end, especially if you put basil or, you know, fresh spinach or something, it's gonna burn. So I learned that. My garlic crust failure. So I love garlic. I really wanted the crust to taste like garlic. So I put garlic pieces. I thought it was gonna be really good. Didn't taste like garlic at all. So next time I'm gonna put maybe garlic powder so it's more spread throughout and add. Super welcoming, very into nature, very into fishing. New Zealanders love fishing. They love fresh fish, and quite a few restaurants that we went to, the dock was literally connected to the restaurant, and the boats would just pull up, they'd unload their fish, and they put it wow. directly into the fryer or directly in the oven. So super fresh. So I attempted to make fish and chips, and I think it turned out quite well. I was very happy with the results. This is my first time beer battering and frying it. I love frying things. I have a new love of frying, even though it's so bad for you. have tartar sauce, and at first it tastes a little funky, but I found that it tasted much better if I chilled it for a little while. Also, double frying potatoes. Have you guys ever double fried potatoes? So it's a technique that I learned about on YouTube. So you fry it first at a lower heat for the cooking oil, and as it's frying, it's cooking the inside. Lower heat for longer, and then you take it off, you let it cool a little bit, and then you put it again at a higher level, and it cooks the outside and makes it crispy. So instead of having like a soft inside, it's perfect throughout. Double frying is great. And also, my family and my boyfriend really benefited from this project. I fed them everything. So Vietnam is our next place that we're going to stop at. The banh mi sandwiches in Vietnam. Vietnam has some of the best food. I really wanted to make pho, but that is a process. It's really hard. Because you have to make the
broth.
Okay. It has to sit for 24 hours or longer.
Okay.
So I pickled my own vegetables. So I do have a vegetable garden, and I have my own carrots. So I pick the carrots from the garden, and I learned how to pickle. Also very easy. So you just take vinegar and water and salt, you just put it in a bowl, and then it's magically pickled. Marinating, another thing that I should have done more of. I usually just would get home from work or get home from school and just want to eat right then. So that was something that I learned, that I should plan a little bit further ahead so I can marinate it and have it taste better for, 2 hours. I overcooked the chicken. I was so afraid that it was going to be undercooked, so I actually overcooked it, and it was a little bit rubbery. So that was something that I worked on in my later projects, and that it's super fun to have a cooking buddy. So my boyfriend helped me out, and cooking was just so much more enjoyable, and this project was so much more enjoyable. So Thailand, next spot. Thailand has amazing food as well. They also have some really weird food. We ate bugs in Thailand, that's the top picture. And we also scorpion and crickets and all sorts of things that you can buy on the street. I had a lot, this was when I kind of hit a wall. I had a lot of difficulty with this dish. I had woken up at 5 in the morning to, go to Long Beach Memorial, teach the ICU students. It was Saturday, so it was due at midnight, and then I went to two stores, and I couldn't find the Thai curry. It comes in a little bottle if you've ever made it, and I knew exactly what it looked like. I just couldn't find it, and I was really hangry, really tired, really frustrated. I was like, I'm done, I'm just going to go to Chipotle, but I didn't. I actually ended up finding it at Whole Foods, and I learned that it's such a good idea not to procrastinate, especially on projects that do take some time to plan it ahead, maybe get the ingredients a day or two before, and then do it, Saturday, it's fine. And cooking is therapeutic, so I was angrily, chopping the vegetables, this is so dumb, why am I doing this to myself? And I felt so much better after chopping the vegetables, and so much better after I ate my yummy food. Pad See Ew in Thailand. Because I had kind of a difficult experience with the Thai curry, I really wanted to try again. So I cooked another Thai dish. Gathering the ingredients can be an adventure. So some ethnic foods are, you can't just go to Ralph's and buy some of these ingredients. You have to go somewhere, an Asian market. So I actually went to a ranch market in Artesia, which was really fun. And I just perused the aisles and looked around. They had big containers of cow's blood for cow pudding. They had purple chickens, all sorts of weird things. They had fish that are super fresh. They're in the tank, but you can buy a fish and then just go home and cook it right away. So that was its own little mini adventure. Marinated. I did the marinating this time, and it tasted so much better, and I also didn't overcook the chicken. This is my dad in his natural habitat. He had 3 helpings of my patsy. Malaysia was the next stop in our trip. So chicken rendang in Malaysia. So a little bit, I did a lot of different things in Malaysia, but one of the reasons why I went there was for Sipadan, which is one of the best dive sites in the world. So I'm going to show you a little bit about what I saw on my dives, and then I would come up and then I would eat amazing food like this on the boat. So when I think of chicken rendang, I think of diving here.
That was a big big fish.
Those are a humpback parrotfish. So, I learned a lot of things from this dish, and these are some of the really funny comments that Kevin and my dad and me made. So, especially my dad said, so what country are we in today? God, that stinks. Whatever it is going to peel the paint right off the walls. My house smelled for 2 days of this dish. I put way too much lemongrass in. I don't know, maybe like 7 stalks of lemongrass, because that's what online said to do. So I put it in there, and I learned that you're not supposed to add things all at the same time. Like, it's a much better idea just to add a little bit, taste it, add a little bit, taste it. Also, make sure if it's supposed to be red, that something in the ingredients list is actually red, because I went back and I think I maybe just got a bad recipe because it did not even turn out the right color. So. Last stop is going to be Indonesia. Gado-gado, so Indonesia will always hold a special place in my heart. I actually lived there for 2 months and thought quite seriously about moving there permanently. So right down the street from where I lived was a little warung, so a restaurant next to a couple other shops, and they serve the best gado-gado. So probably not a lot of you know what this is. So it's a peanut sauce on top of some veggies and tofu, and usually I put these like shrimp chips on top. Sounds really strange. A lot of people don't like it, but I loved it. So I would go diving during the day, and then I would come home, and it'd be super hot, and then I would just go down the street because I didn't want to pay for food and buy some gado-gado. And I was actually very happy. My friend from Indonesia helped me out a lot. He told me, you know, the right ratios to do things and to create this, and I was very happy with the turnout. But I didn't find the shrimp chips. I wasn't sure where to find that, and I think it needed that little bit of crunch, so texture. So summary and application, I learned a lot of new recipes. I also went down memory lane for all of these countries that I went to, and even just making this PowerPoint, just going through my pictures, it was a very enjoyable experience. So how it applies to teaching and to learning itself. So learning from failures, so like chicken rendang, for example, like I learned way more from that than I did from the other recipes where it was pretty easy, pretty straightforward. So I learned a lot more, and then how you respond to failure is up to you. You can either be really upset that you failed and now you have your house that smells really like lemons, or you can, you know, be happy that you had this experience and can move on. So I think that's a good thing to have in the back of your mind as a teacher, and to try and instill that to your students as well, that failure is not a bad thing. Planning ahead, so really big thing for really life in general. Like you want to plan ahead. You want to plan ahead so that it's not stressful, it's not frustrating, it's not something that you dread doing at the end of the day. As a student, this can be, don't, you know, wait till the last minute to do a paper, don't wait till the last minute to do a project, because it won't be enjoyable and you probably won't get the learning experience out of it. And as an instructor, make sure your lesson plans are, you know, done ahead of time. Make sure you have the projects laid out so then the students know what the expectations are, and then they also, but you have to be careful because you don't want it to be so rigid and so planned out that you can't be flexible. So you have to be also flexible in the planning. Meaning, so teamwork, I think as an instructor, I'm gonna wanna, you know, make sure that I include groups. work as well, because I think it's really important to not only learn individually, but also as a team. And I learned things, you know, working with Kevin or working with my dad on this project or working with my friend over the phone, that teamwork is really important and it just leads to a different experience. Meaningful assignments and motivation. So this project I actually really, really liked and really loved. And it was, I felt like I was so much more motivated to do this versus writing a paper. I don't like papers, so I wouldn't really get as much out of it. But I feel like because I really enjoyed this and it was meaningful to me, that I learned more. So making assignments meaningful as an instructor for your students so that they get more out of it. And the importance of reflection. So not only doing what I had to do, so not only making my recipe and eating my recipe, but thinking about, you know, what did I actually learn? And writing it up in the blog was awesome, because I wouldn't have really thought about it as in depth. I would have just eaten my food and gone along with my day, but I thought about it in depth, so now I can work on it next time I make it.
Do you think that helped you with the chicken, you know, like you did a couple chicken dishes and you overcooked it, and the marinating, do you think that's what helped you, or do you think that would have just happened?
I think I would have been less likely to marinate again next time. It probably would have taken me a few more recipes to catch on, like, oh, I haven't done that the last four times.
Okay.
Maybe I should do that this time. The fact that I feel like I picked it up faster because I did and spent the extra time reflecting.
Interesting.
So learning objectives. So can someone please verbalize two difficulties that I experienced or that you could potentially experience?
Add things as you go, not all.
It's a big one. Anyone can do the second one?
Plan
ahead, yes. Second one, state one way difficulty can be improved. So any of the dishes, were there any improvements that I came up with?
Marinating,
correct. Okay, and then state two ways in which learning how to cook